Today we're going to talk about motivation. How are individuals, teams, motivated within the organization to enhance overall employee satisfaction and obviously productivity and performance? The term motivate comes from the Latin word movere, which basically means to cause movement. So moving something from point A to point B. In employees' case, obviously, we're talking about their ability to take action toward higher productivity. So motivation is about causing others, such as employees, to move toward some predetermined overall organizational objective or goal. Psychologically, motivation deals with other employees' needs. Now, motivation is the psychological forces within a person that determines the direction of behavior in the organization, the persistence displayed in meeting those goals within the organization, as well as the intensity in effort or how hard people work toward a specific goal or objective. There's intrinsic motivation, which is behavior performed for its own sake. So motivation comes from performing the work itself. And then there's extrinsic motivation, which is behavior performed to acquire certain rewards or outcomes. So motivation source here is the consequence of the action.
So can managers really motivate employees? Can they cause movement in the behavior or direction of an employee's
action? The answer is yes, but we do that by creating an environment where employees are motivated. A beginning place would be to determine employees' needs. Needs are deficiencies that a person might experience at a given time. It may be physiological, psychological, or even sociological. Those employees with deficiencies are more susceptible to motivational efforts. So it requires managers to get to know their employees, and large span of control with managers unfortunately makes it difficult to get to know every employee in his or her needs very well. In terms of categories of motivational theories, well, there are content theories of motivation and then there are process theories of motivation. Content theories of motivations focus on what actually motivates employees. These are factors within the person and the needs that motivates people. Process theories of motivations describe, explain, and analyze how behavior is energized, directed, sustained, and stopped. So most motivational theories would either fall under the content theories of motivation or under the process theories of motivation. So let's talk about content theories of motivation. One of them would be Maslow's. Abraham Maslow hypothesized that within every human being, there exists a hierarchy of five needs, beginning with the physiological needs that include hunger, thirst, shelter, sex, and other bodily needs. The second level is safety needs that include security as well as protection from physical and emotional harm. The third level is social needs that include affection, belonging, acceptance, friendship. The next level is the esteem needs that include internal esteem factors such as self-respect, autonomy, and achievement, as well as external esteem factors such as status, recognition, and attention. At the top, the fifth level of the hierarchy is self-actualization needs. This is the drive to become what a person is capable of becoming, and it can include growth, achieving one's potential, and self-fulfillment. So Maslow separated the five needs into higher and lower order needs. As a need becomes substantially satisfied, the next need becomes dominant. So he or she would be striving to meet that next need. No need is ever fully gratified. A substantially satisfied need no longer motivates a person.
So in terms of need hierarchy approach, keep in mind that a satisfied need ceases to motivate employees. Unsatisfied needs can cause frustration, conflict, and stress. People have a need to grow and develop. They strive to move up the hierarchy in order to eventually achieve their self-esteem and self-actualization needs. There are some need hierarchy issues that obviously academic documents, textbooks, and articles talk about. There's little data that proves that a needs hierarchy actually exists. Only two needs levels exist, the physiological and then all the others. Security needs decrease as managers advance into higher levels of the hierarchy in an organization, with a corresponding increase in need for social interaction, achievement, and self-actualization. So as you move up, obviously, we tend to strive for higher order needs.
Alderfer's ERG or ERG needs correspond to Maslow's hierarchy as well. So you have the E, which means existence, the R for relatedness, and G for growth needs. So existence needs would be the physiological and safety, relatedness needs would be the belonging, social, and love, and the growth needs would be esteem and self-actualization needs. So there's a frustration regression process that exists. If one continually fails to satisfy growth needs, the related needs re-emerge. Efforts will be redirected towards satisfying, obviously, a lower order need. We also have Herzberg's two-factor theory. Herzberg's two-factor theory basically has two parts. You have the dissatisfiers, otherwise known as hygiene factors, and then you have the motivators, which is what we call the intrinsic needs or things that actually motivate employees. So they go beyond the satisfaction. So that the hygiene factors can include job security, working conditions, your status in the organization, the procedures and processes, as well as the interpersonal relations we might have with our bosses or employees. But what's interesting is that the hygiene factors, or otherwise known as the dissatisfiers, can also include salary. So in other words, salary is not included in the motivator category. So what are the motivators, according to Herzberg's two-factor theory? Well, this could be the job content, achievement, recognition, responsibility, advancement, the possibility of growth within the company or within your profession in the field, actually. So these would be items that actually motivate employees.
So salary is not in the category of motivators simply because it's a short-term motivator. So we all want money, we all need money, and we all need a good salary, but too much of it does not necessarily motivate you to continue working at a high level of performance. At least once you have some of it, then it ceases to obviously motivate people at high levels.
There is the discussion on job enrichment in Herzberg's two-factor theory. So job enrichment simply builds personal achievement, recognition, challenge, responsibility, and growth opportunities into the job. So people would become highly motivated and stay that way. Job enrichment increases a person's motivation by providing more discretion and accountability in terms of how the job is done and obviously the responsibility that comes with that. We also have McClelland's learned needs theory. McClelland believed that needs are acquired from culture. There's a need for achievement, there's the need for affiliation, there's the need for power. When a need is strong, there's motivation to use behavior that leads to its satisfaction. Factors that reflect a high need for achievement could include things like liking to take responsibility for solving problems, setting moderate achievement goals, and taking calculated risks when we're performing our jobs. And the desires for feedback on performance in how, obviously, employees are doing and how they can make improvements. So these all could be signs for a need for achievement. Factors that reflect a high need for affiliation could include desires for social interaction, being concerned about the quality of personal relationships, and also social relationships tend to take precedence over task accomplishment for those who have a high need for affiliation. And factors reflecting a high need for power could be concentrating or obtaining and exercising your power and authority in every opportunity that you get. Being concerned with influencing others and winning arguments finally, we can say that power can be negative or positive, depending, obviously, on how it's used. If power is used to enhance the workplace, that's a positive view of it. On the other hand, if it's used to manipulate people and get only your personal goals, not necessarily the department's or organizational goals, that could be a negative use of power. So content theories focus primarily on the needs and incentives that cause behavior. The process theories of motivation are concerned with answering the questions of how individual behavior is energized, directed, maintained, and stopped. You have theories such as expectancy, equity, and goal setting that fall in the process theories of motivation. Expectancy theory states that our tendency to act in a certain way depends on an expectation that the act will be followed by a given outcome and on the attractiveness of that outcome to the employee. There are three relationships here: effort-performance relationship, performance-reward relationship, as well as reward-personal goals relationship. So instrumentality in Victor Rohn's expectancy theory basically is the perception that the first level outcomes, which is performance, are tied to second level outcomes, which is rewards or punishment. Valences an individual's preferences for the outcome. In expectancy is the belief that a particular behavior will be followed by a particular outcome. So expectancy theory helps explain why many workers are not motivated and only do the minimum amount of work, as theory X managers would tend to believe. There are several questions employees need to answer in the affirmative if their motivation is to be maximized. For example, if I give maximum effort, will I be recognized in my performance appraisal? Number two, if I get a good performance appraisal, will it lead to organizational rewards like promotion, a better pay, or even getting a corner office, and so on? Third, if I'm rewarded, are the rewards attractive to me individually, perhaps to me, to my family, and to my future in the field or in the profession? Next, we have Douglas McGregor's Theory X and Theory Y. So Douglas McGregor was a pioneer in the study of human behavior in the workplace. He authored a book on the human side of enterprise and wrote many articles. His ideas were derived from Maslow's need satisfaction model of motivation. He said that Theory X people basically ignore responsibility. In Theory Y, people would enjoy working. So according to Douglas McGregor, in the Theory X model, managers believe that people dislike work and can be lazy. Therefore, they need to be told what to do and how to do it on a regular basis while also monitoring them. According to the Theory Y view, workers enjoy work and especially crave involvement and engagement in meaningful work. So in this view, workers want responsibility, and the correct way to lead is through delegation for Theory Y employees. So years later comes this researcher by the name of William Ochi, who created Theory Z of motivation, and it combines parts of both the Asian and the Western structures. In Theory Z, management and motivation, managers would stress long-term employment, work groups, and organizational focus in order to create a motivational work environment for all employees. Theory Z focused on increasing employee loyalty to the company by providing a job for life with a strong focus on well-being of the employee, both on the job as well as off the job. According to Ouchi, Theory Z management tends to promote a stable employment environment, high productivity, and high employee morale and satisfaction on a continuous basis. So some characteristics that are associated with Theory Z would be long-term employment and job security, collective responsibility, implicit informal control with explicit formalized measures, collective decision-making, slow evaluation and promotion, moderately specialized careers, as well as concern for a total person, which includes their family. So this is where the life balance comes in for employees. Next, we have the equity theory. One's perception of being treated fairly in social exchange can influence motivation in the workplace. So equity exists when an employee perceives that the ratio of his or her inputs or efforts to their outcomes, such as rewards, equals the ratio of other employees. In other words, if you're getting less benefits from your job compared to another worker or an employee, then obviously there's inequity. When employees perceive an inequity, they can be predicted to make one of several choices: change their inputs, change their outcomes, distort perceptions of the self, distort perceptions of the other individuals involved, choose a different referring point, or even leave the company, the profession overall. There was a blind beggar. The blind beggar sat on the steps of a building with a hat by his feet. He held up a sign which said, "I am blind, please help." There were only a few coins in the hat. However, a person passed by and noticed that not many people were dropping some coins. So he changed the sign, and all of a sudden, more people were dropping money into the hat. The boy noticed a huge change in the before and after. And that afternoon, the man who changed the sign was walking by, and the boy recognized his footsteps and asked, "Were you the one who changed my sign this morning?" The man replied, "Yes." The boy says, "What did you write?" The man said, "I only wrote the truth. I said what you had said, but I said it in a different way."
Sign.
I wrote the same, but in different words.
Thanks, love.
Today is a beautiful day, but I cannot see it. You see, the conclusion here is that words, when used effectively, can communicate and motivate people in the workplace. So there are many theories, obviously, of motivation, but the words you choose makes a difference in whether employees stay with you and perform well, or basically eventually leave. In motivational theories of organizational behavior, we also talk about self-determination theory. Self-determination theory basically says that people prefer to feel they have control over their actions. And people who are paid for the work often feel less like they want to do it and more like they have to do it because, again, of the monetary exchange. So the theory proposes that in addition to being driven by a need for autonomy, people also seek ways to achieve competence and positive connections to others, both in the workplace as well as in their professions. When extrinsic rewards are used as payoffs for performance, employees feel they are doing a good job. Eliminating extrinsic rewards can also shift an individual's perception of why he or she works on a task from an external to an internal explanation. So self-determination theory acknowledges that extrinsic rewards can improve even extrinsic motivation under specific circumstances. A recent outgrowth of self-determination theory is self-concordance. which considers how strongly people's reasons for pursuing their goals are consistent with their interest in core values. If individuals pursue goals because of an intrinsic interest, they're more likely to attain their goals and are happy even if they do not. The process of striving toward them is fun in itself. In contrast, people who pursue goals for extrinsic reasons, like money or status, are less likely to attain their goals and are also less happy even when they do, because the goals are less meaningful to them. So organizational behavior research suggests that people who pursue work goals for intrinsic reasons are more satisfied with their jobs, feel they fit into the organization, and may actually perform better both in the short term as well as in the long term. So researchers have said that individuals' conscious goals and intentions are the primary determinants of their behavior. Once a person starts something, he or she pushes on until the goal is actually achieved to his or her level of satisfaction. Harder goals result in higher levels of performance if the goals are accepted by the individual. So in a way, aim for the moon. Even if you miss, you'll still be among the stars. When it comes to goal setting, there are certain terms that we should be aware of. Goal specificity, difficulty, intensity, as well as commitment make a difference, obviously, in whether a person is motivated to achieve them or not. Goal specificity is the degree of quantitative precision or the clarity of the goal. Goal difficulty is the degree of proficiency or the level of performance that is sought. Goal intensity pertains to the process of setting the goal or of determining how to reach it. And goal commitment is the amount of effort used to achieve a goal. So obviously, we want to have stretch goals, or goals that basically forces us or motivates us to go beyond the norm. And those goals should be obviously meaningful to the employee in order for it to be achieved successfully. The exchange theory states that employees engage in reasonably predictable give-and-take relationships. So what is exchange with, between, and among employees can actually impact their level of motivation, commitment, performance, and overall satisfaction in the workplace. According to Edgar Schein, the degree to which employees exert effort, commit to goals, and derive satisfaction from their work depends on the extent to which employee expectations match the organization's expectations. The specific nature of what is exchanged can make a huge difference. A perception that the organization has failed to fulfill an unwritten exchange agreement can obviously be devastating to the employee's motivation and his or her relationship to the organization. A violation in the psychological contract can lead to decreased job satisfaction as well as decreased citizenship behaviors. In summary, we can say that managers can influence the motivation state of their employees. They can create an environment where people can achieve their goals and stay motivated. Managers should be sensitive to variations in employees' needs, abilities, as well as goals. Managers also must consider differences in the preferences or balances for rewards in each employee based on his or her level of needs and or his or her differences in culture. Managers need to work on providing employees with jobs that offer task challenge, diversity, and a variety of opportunities for need satisfaction. Overall, keep in mind that motivation is not permanent, since there are too many demotivators in life every single day. So we need to constantly feed our minds with, obviously, good literature, positive ways to think about our jobs and achieve our goals, and also to maintain a positive outlook on life. You see, research shows that over 90% of our daily communication seems to be of a negative nature. So we need to have positive input into our minds and the employees' minds into the department in order to keep everyone motivated. This way, the literature on positive thinking can be helpful, because positive thinking will help you obviously do everything better than negative thinking in any given day, week, or in any department or organization. It's been said that if you want to change your life, then you need to do it immediately and make behavioral changes with a commitment that you actually communicate to your colleagues, to your bosses, as well as to your friends and family members. Overall, once you know what you want and are committed to it, then training is what brings about positive behavioral changes in life to develop a motivating and obviously positive outlook in life. To change a habit or a behavior that is demotivating to you, you can obviously first and foremost decide to change. Number two, get help. Number three, as Zig Ziglar would emphasize, try substitution, replacing an undesirable habit with a better habit. And number four, use visualization, or what is also known as imagineering, sort of like what Disney World employees have done for creativity, to see yourself successfully doing the desired activities for your life. So it can keep you motivated toward performance, obviously, and higher productivity. And last but not least, number five, when you want to bring about behavioral changes, you need to do something new for at least 21 to 30 different days. You need to do it consciously. Even though you might feel uncomfortable and awkward, you need to keep doing it, because a habit is formed after 21 to 30 days of consecutively doing the new activity on a regular basis. Then it becomes obviously subconscious or a habit for you. So stay motivated and keep your colleagues and employees motivated.